Good morning and welcome to this workshop on cyber security. I am Deepak Phatak. I am the principal investigator of the T10KT project, under which we attempt to engage up to 10,000 teachers for their empowerment through such workshops. I am very glad to note that there are more than 200 centers participating and more than 6,000 teachers participating in this workshop. This is especially commendable because the semesters would have started in many places, and yet people have found time from their busy schedule to come and participate in this. It is my pleasant duty to welcome two of my colleagues who are the faculty in charge for this workshop. Professor Bernard, welcome Bernard. Professor Shivkumar, welcome, please. At the outset, let me also welcome part of the team that conducts these workshops here, and one special guest, Professor Lagu. He is our advisor. He was our faculty colleague many years ago. I'll tell more about him later during my brief talk here. As you may be aware, these workshops are tailored to specific national needs. Ordinarily, we address teachers on the common subjects which they teach. But the cyber security is such an important topic these days that we decided, and we are very sure that sooner or later, as a full-fledged elective course, if not a core course, it will be assimilated into our computer science, IT, and such syllabi. Currently, I believe you have computer security as part of networking course, which also is a core course in CS and IT programs. The initiation for this workshop happened through a meeting in Delhi in the Prime Minister's office, where the looming cyber threats and their propensity to increase beyond the hacker community was considered with great seriousness, and it was envisaged that India must secure its digital assets, which are currently distributed across hundreds of thousands of servers at various places, including block level in panchayat and individual institutions such as ours and the organizations and so on. It is estimated that we may require more than 4,400,000 information security officers over the next 3 years. Naturally, by conventional means, it is impossible to train so many people. So the first effort was contemplated to train the teachers, not necessarily teachers of engineering colleges alone, but teachers of polytechnic, teachers of any kind who dabble with computer networks and security, and empower them with sufficient knowledge on cybersecurity so that they can in turn over the next 2 or 3 years conduct crash programs to train the prospective information security officers. This is the genesis. Our mission director, Mr. Praveen Prakash, personally coordinated these efforts in the mission, requested us to conduct this program. And another person who is firmly behind this effort is Dr. Gulshan Rai. Some of you might have heard of him as the CERT-IN. He is the highest authority in the country to supervise on the policies and their implementation for the government resources as far as computer security is concerned. I am very fortunate that when I requested two of my colleagues here, Professor Bernard Menezes and Professor Shivkumar, they readily agree. Some of you may be aware that to conduct a workshop of this kind, the faculty members have to spend a back-breaking 2 or 3 months of effort jointly with several teaching assistants. Can we welcome the teaching assistants which Professor Bernard has managed to get? Welcome, and thank you so much for helping us out in this. These young friends will naturally be working constantly with our faculty team, looking at the questions raised in the discussion fora, looking at the assignments submitted and so on. And I believe that it would be a very great and useful experience for all of you. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the workshop coordinators at more than 200 remote centers. Quite some time ago, Professor Bernard and Professor Shivakumar had conducted a similar workshop for the coordinators from the point of view of enabling them to set up the labs and the open source tools and other things which are required for all the participants today to start conducting their lab sessions in their respective RCs. That was a very well attended seminar, workshop, and the coordinators, I must tell all of you that they work really overtime, many people spending late evenings and nights, I remember, and they are now well versed with the tools that will be used later. More details on the workshop, etc., will follow later. I want to use some 10 minutes of your time now to just share some common perceptions and the antidotes that we are trying to work on altogether. So security is something that all of us are aware of at various levels. However, all of us Indians as a society are far less sensitive to detailed aspects of security. Our notion of security is we lock our house and that's good enough kind of security. But information security particularly is not something that we are adept at. The attacks on any information content can take various forms. The most common form is of course stealing of information, and that is what we are most worried about. But wherever information is being disseminated, wherever information is being used, wherever transactions are being done, particularly online transactions, there is an equally great danger of hackers clobbering up all our servers and denying the service to the genuine user. This is called the denial of service attack, if I am not mistaken. There could also be fraudulent inputs that could be given to a system, for example, a system which is trying to get people registered for a workshop like this. Now, ordinarily, only genuine people will register. But what if 1 million Indians simply thought of putting in their application and give some fake names? How do you counter that? That is why we have these additional controls as address, institution where you teach and so on, so that we can verify these things. I recall many years ago when there were no computers and people used to apply for shares. That would be sort of a lottery system. Some people would get allocated. So it was not uncommon to get 1,000 applications of different names, but from the same physical address. So I remember a firm in Ahmedabad had specialized in filling up forms with names such as A.A. Shah, A.B. Shah, A.C. Shah, A.D. Shah, and then B.A. Shah, B.B. Shah, and so on. And I had wryly commented that they should start their business in Andhra Pradesh, where it is not uncommon to find four or five initials, such as my ex-colleague Professor S.S.S.P. Rao. So you could have ABCD Rao, ABCE Rao, and so on, and that would give rise to many permutations. Of course, the trick worked for the first simple reason that only few were to be selected for allocation of shares, and those few would then be scrutinized so that if there are multiple names from the same physical address, they could be sort of removed. You can imagine a denial of service attack even in the conventional information dissemination network. Let's say there's a municipal corporation window which is accepting some forms for gas connection or electricity connection or something like that. Now there is a genuine customer like you and I would go and you'll find a queue. And let's say you find a queue of 500 people. You might just decide to come next day or you might stand behind those 500. Then you notice that each person, the 500, actually fills up the form, comes back and stands in the queue again. So basically these are 500 fake customers whose only ambition in life is to deny service to genuine customers. This example is not hypothetical anymore because as all of you know, in modern days online transactions, this is exactly what results in denial of service attacks and then its larger brother, the distributed denial of service. Unfortunately, my knowledge of computer security and attacks roughly ends at this point. Fortunately, we have people who are great experts in these things. Let me tell you that both of them have been involved in advising many large organizations, government organizations, on how to establish security measures. They themselves are accomplished faculty members. Bernard has written a book. In fact, I persuaded him to consider keeping that book as the reference material. I believe the books have been obtained. Most probably they have been distributed to the remote centers. I do not know, but please check up with your workshop coordinators. I believe that the books that we had procured should have reached the remote centers. I also request workshop coordinators, if there is any shortage, they should immediately let us know so that additional copies could be sent by the workshop team here. Talking about cyber security, I would like all of you to remember an Estonian incident, I think it was 2002, when the entire Estonian commercial systems practically came to a halt because of a massive attack. It took 2 days for Estonia to recover. What is more important is that later on it was established that this attack did not come from a group of hackers. It actually was a state-sponsored attack. Needless to add, understanding the importance of attacking information resources, different states have started using these as part of a war weapon. So essentially, the future wars are likely to be fought not only the conventional way, but in the cyberspace using the cyber attack. A nation, therefore, has to guard against such attacks assiduously. And that is exactly what, hopefully, is the policy and desire of the Government of India. And that is why we are here talking. I will make only two concluding remarks. One, as far as this workshop is concerned, please remember that it is not just a subject that you will be teaching, but you will be teaching people, not only your students, but other people, empowering them to fight such threats. It is very, very important, very, very vital, not only for your individual institutions, other individual organizations, but to nation as a whole. The second point I would like to make is that whenever such workshops are conducted, the workshop schedule is ordinarily adhered to, but often there is some delay in starting something, some delay in getting a cup of tea, for example, during the tea break and so on. At IIT Bombay, we have tried desperately over the last several years to establish very strong and firm practices of discipline. You would have noticed that we started exactly at 9:30 this session. All sessions will start sharp on time. Since the remote centers are required to be connected on internet and there is some work that needs to be done, I request workshop coordinators once again to ensure that their labs and facilities are opened at 9 o'clock, that their technical staff comes there at 9, and that the entire login, check-in, etc., happens well before 9:30. I would also request all participants to ensure that they are in their respective places of attendance at least 3 to 4 minutes before the beginning of any session. Let us adhere to these time limits, because it is a very large workshop. Ordinarily in a class, when the teacher is personally present and the students are physically present, people would come in time. But we are addressing you from remote distances, and therefore it is only your self-discipline that will help us conduct this workshop in a timely fashion. Last but not the least, courses like these, and in fact almost all engineering courses, heavily depend upon a proper hands-on practice. For the hands-on practice, my colleagues and the workshop coordinators have worked very hard to provide appropriate facilities and the appropriate exercises in the lab sessions in the afternoon. I request you to take these lab sessions at least as seriously as the interactive lecture sessions, if not more seriously, because they form a vital component of the entire learning and our empowerment. With these words, I will conclude my inaugural talk. I request all of you a warm participation and a very meaningful participation. Once again, I would like to thank my colleagues. There is one component of our team which was probably not seen well, and that is my workshop team here, led by Dr. Mukta Atre was here somewhere. Yeah, she's there. Jaya, she's our senior finance person. The workshop coordinators and remote center coordinators perhaps would have heard Jaya Gayatonde's name. Can you raise your hand? Yeah. She's our finance minister, so she handles all the finances for the project. Mahendra and Kanan and other people you're dealing with. It is indeed because of such people who have been working round the clock that we are able to handle such workshops. So thank you very much, and I am very happy to leave you in very able and experienced and passionate hands of Professor Bernard Meneses and Professor Shiv Kumar. Thank you so much. All yours.